welcome to day two. Thank you very much once again for joining us. We're super excited to start today's sessions off with physics focus, which of course is my main interest and day job. And our first speaker today is Fiala Shanahan, from associate professor from MIT. She's an expert in theoretical particle physics and specializes in calculations for QCD and lattice field theory. And actually, one of the first times I met Fiala was when she gracefully agreed to the invitation to join us for a colloquium here at Chicago several years, actually just before the pandemic, where she told us about the infusion of symmetries into machine learning techniques that she has pioneered for performing these calculations. So I'm super excited to hear from Fiala today. So let's give her a round of applause. Thank you, Fiala.
Okay, let's see how this goes. Thank you. So I'm really happy to be here and really happy to kick off the physics session. Okay, so as David said, one of the big things I'm interested in is understanding the structure of matter from our fundamental physics theories. So we have the standard model of nuclear and particle physics, which is a framework that was put together in the 1970s, and it describes, as far as we know, just 17 fundamental particles and their interactions, and it tells us everything about the structure of the proton all the way up to nuclear reactions, in principle all the way up the periodic table and beyond. And so we'd really like to do calculations from this fundamental physics theory, both for its own sake. Can we really understand the emergence of all of the complexity in nature from this fundamental theory? But also secondly, because we know there is physics beyond what's described in the standard model, for example, dark matter, and we want to understand that better. And part of setting the backgrounds and benchmarks for the experiment searching for this physics is to understand the standard model itself, right? So that's the premise. We want to study this fundamental physics theory. And doing that, as we'll get into a little bit more later, really demands extreme scale computation. So the last data I have is something like 10% of open science supercomputing in the United States goes to just this class of problems. So first principles calculations of the standard model, right? But despite that, we are massively computationally limited. So even with exascale machines, and I'll just sort of give you an attempt at a sense of that. I know exactly what to write down to calculate the scattering of dark matter from the particles in my detectors on Earth, something that I need to really interpret dark matter direct detection experiments. But we can't do it even with all the supercomputing in the world. We're a few orders of magnitude away. And so really we'd like algorithms that are a few orders of magnitude better so we can answer some of these fundamental questions, right? So that really brings in the question of, well, what about AI and machine learning in this space, right? So we're in a situation where we have a fundamental physics theory. We want to do calculations of that theory, and those calculations have a right answer, right? 2 + 2 = 4, no matter how you do it, that should be the answer, right? And so that's exactly what we want to do here. And this is true sort of generically. I want to do calculations of the standard model, but you might be interested in calculations of any other theory that you have written down, right? Any other numerical calculations. So it really becomes a problem framing question for how to use AI. I want to use AI to accelerate these calculations, but I can't change the answer. I've got no room for approximations, errors, modeling, any sort of uncertainties that I can't guarantee go away in some limit, you know, that's not systematically removable. So the only thing I can do is this. I have to frame the problem so that no matter what I do on the AI side, I'll still get the right answer, right? But maybe it'll be really, really slow. Maybe it would have been better to not use AI at all, right? Like before I train the algorithm, maybe it's, you know, not worth doing, but hopefully, if I have really good AI, really well-trained machine learning models, well, I still get the right answer because I should always get the right answer, but hopefully it's a lot faster, right? So it becomes entirely a problem framing question. So there's several ways of doing this, and all of the examples I know fall into the three categories I'll talk about. If you have other examples, I'd love to chat about them at a coffee break. But so the first way is do the calculation the same way, but do it faster. So I'm gonna visualize this process like this. You go from the start to the end, and this is always the same, right? It's some provably exact theoretical physics calculation. It's just how you get there might be different. So the first way, do it the same way but faster, would look something like this to me. You're going along the same path, and examples that fall into this category are, well, maybe you have an existing algorithm with a lot of free parameters. Maybe you can tune those very efficiently using AI so that your algorithm runs faster, right? The people who like inverting matrices, one example of that just very explicitly would be algebraic multigrid is a great way of inverting matrices, has a lot of free parameters. We've shown that you can accelerate that by optimizing those parameters with machine learning. Okay, another problem. Transform the problem into a different one, but where you know mathematically that it has the same solution. So if you like, this is just thinking about changes of variables very broadly defined, which if you have something low dimensional, maybe you can just write down a change of variables. If you're talking about, say, the problems I care about, where you have integrations in 10 to the 12 dimensions, writing down a change of variables gets really, really hard. But it's something that you can do with machine learning. And so if you can transform the problem into one that you know is the same, but is easier to solve, then you've done this, essentially, right? You've maybe gone from a different start. You've changed the length of the path you have to go, and then you can use your same normal algorithms to solve it, and you know it's exact in all the usual ways, right? Okay, another example is, well, maybe you can solve a different problem that's easier to solve, but then you need to know you can fix it. So to me, that looks something like this. So that would be, you know, I keep coming back to linear solvers. You can do a sloppy solve and you know how to correct it with high precision solves. Or maybe you're sampling a probability distribution and you know how to sample a nearby probability distribution and then correct it to get back your guarantees of exactness. And so these are all ways of using machine learning in this case for this step here, right? And then the correctness you'll have to fix some other way, where you can use machine learning to accelerate your calculations without bringing in any uncertainties and hopefully enable calculations that aren't computationally tractable any other way. Okay, so I considered trying to give examples in all of these categories, but I think we'll be better served by going into a little bit of detail on one, which is something we've spent a long time developing over the last 5 years or so. And it's exactly for this problem that I outlined before. We want to do first principles calculations of the standard model, you know, equations that we can write down. We want to do calculations within this framework. Okay, so in particular, I'll give you just a little bit of physics background. We care about the strong force part of the standard model that's described by the theory of quantum chromodynamics, or QCD. The strong nuclear force, that's the force that binds the fundamental particles, the quarks and gluons, into protons and neutrons, and it binds the protons and neutrons into nuclei. So it's really relevant if we're talking about the structure of those protons, neutrons, and nuclei. But this part is really difficult to do calculations within, right? So part of the problem is that what we call the coupling of the theory, so that's, if you like, the strength of interactions, it changes with the energy scale. And when you're at high energies, the coupling is small. And of course, if you square a small number, it gets smaller still, right? So you can do a perturbative expansion in powers of that coupling and know that all the higher order terms that you're neglecting are small by some measure, and you can keep adding terms and you can have a systematic approach to calculations. When you get to the left, to low energies, you can't do that anymore. And so you're only left with numerical approaches. Right, so this becomes non-perturbative, if you like. And why are we interested in low energies? We'll say the structure of a nucleus at rest in a detector would be a low energy type problem, right? So very, very relevant to these questions. So what we're left with is a computational approach to solving these equations, which is called lattice QCD, and it's exactly what it sounds like. You put the equations of the theory onto a four-dimensional space-time grid, or lattice, and then solve them numerically, right? And what that looks like in the end is essentially integrals in a really, really high dimensional space in something like 10 to the 9 to 10 to the 12 dimensions. So of course, doing those integrals is a massive computational challenge. This is the computational challenge I was talking about before. We evaluate them by importance sampling. That is, you sample the most important pieces correspondingly more and the less important pieces correspondingly less. And then this big computational task basically reduces down to a sampling problem. Okay. So we've taken a detour through the physics, but the underlying problem is, I think, something that's relevant for many different areas, that we want to generate samples of some known probability distribution, right? Just probability of these samples is given by the exponential of this quantity. This is the action that's just encoding the theory. That's the dynamics of the fundamental particles in our theory. So this is something known that we can compute, and we want to generate samples according to this known distribution. What those samples really look like in our case here is that you have this hypercube, so really in four dimensions, and on each edge or link of this hypercube, you have an SU3 matrix, so a 3x3 complex matrix with unit determinant. All right, so matrices, on every edge here. And then we, you know, in total have something like 10 to the 12 double precision numbers describing each sample. And then we want a few thousand samples or a few tens of thousands samples from this probability distribution. And so that's the setup of this sort of big fundamental sampling problem that we want to solve and accelerate using machine learning. So how we normally solve this sampling problem is through Hamiltonian or hybrid Monte Carlo. This is just a Markov chain Monte Carlo process where you're updating from one sample to the next by making some small changes, right? And so you have a process of these small changes where you know that in the limit of a large number of samples, you're sampling from the right probability distribution. The problem with this is that you're making small changes from one sample to the next, right? And so they're correlated. And in fact, that correlation, as we take a really important limit, the limit as the lattice spacing goes to zero, which is a limit we have to take to return to our continuum theory, the correlation length grows. And you can think of that just by thinking, I want to change the samples on a scale that's physically relevant, like the size of a proton, right? And if I have a diffusive updating method, as the spacing becomes small, I need more and more and more changes, more and more steps to change physics on this fixed physical length scale. If the lattice spacing is big, I need only a few. If the lattice spacing is small, I need a lot, right? So this is a manifestation of critical slowing down in this context. There are other really important problems like topological freezing, where you're in different topological sectors. And if you're making small steps, you get stuck in like one local minimum and don't sample the other one, right? So this traditional approach has big computational walls that we want to try to beat with machine learning. Okay, so we can visualize the problem like this, if you like. Of course, we actually have matrices on each edge, not these images, but let's visualize these samples like images. I want samples like this. These have sort of correlations on a fixed scale. You see these look sort of similar in some way. Much more often than I want samples like this, this is just random noise. So I want to generate these samples from this probability distribution. It looks like there's a great parallel to something that received a lot of attention in the machine learning community, right? Image generation. And so you would think, okay, if I visualize my samples like this, if I can write in these days really fantastic machine learning frameworks that can give me these fake pictures of people's faces and not this random noise, you should be able to use the same thing to give me these samples much more frequently than this, right? Sounds good. Immediate differences also. And this is where, you know, things really get interesting. That let's stack up a comparison between our problem and this problem that's received a lot of attention in the machine learning community. For us, it's only the set or the ensemble of all of these samples that has meaning. It has to follow a precise probability distribution. And if you're interested in pictures of people's faces, you don't care about the distribution over all faces necessarily. You want each one to look good on its own, right? We don't even have a meaning for what a good sample is. We have a meaning for what the distribution of samples has to be. We also have an extreme inversion of this typical data hierarchy. So the number of degrees of freedom per sample versus the number of samples we might have or want, this ratio here, is completely inverted what you typically see in problems where you have a lot of training data to train your algorithms, right? So anything that needs training data isn't going to work. Long distance correlations, we know, really describe the physics. That's different to, you know, convolutional neural networks have been developed to exploit the fact that in images, a lot of local structures are really important, right? Different. We have symmetries that are really different. Let me give you a taste of those symmetries. So we, of course, have rotation invariance, translation invariance with our four-dimensional boundaries. Okay, we can imagine what that looks like for images. And what we mean by these symmetries is that these two things are the same in our case. They should have exactly the same probability of being generated from our theory. But the symmetries get more complicated. Remember, we have a matrix on each edge of this lattice. And what a gauge transformation is a correlated transformation that you take this link here, that's this SU3 matrix, and I'm going to left and right multiply it by different SU3 matrices, but in a correlated way across this entire four-dimensional lattice. And so what that does is it's changing every link, but in a different way. So you have this really high-dimensional symmetry group, which of course there's no analog of in the image space. So it becomes clear very, very quickly that you can't just take out-of-the-box machine learning methods developed for, say, image generation and apply them to this problem. In the context of our institute, iFi, Jesse will be talking later. He's the director of our institute in the Boston area. We're calling this ab initio AI. But it's really just the same thing we've heard in a number of talks already at this workshop. The idea that you have to design algorithms for the science problems and not just import them wholesale from other areas. Okay, so just one way we can try to address this problem with machine learning, and this is something we've been developing for a number of years now, in a long-term also industry collaboration with Google DeepMind, is through what are called flow models. So what a flow model is, it's just a map between probability distributions, right? And what from one distribution here to another distribution here. And what makes this map a flow is just that it's invertible. It has a tractable Jacobian. It's a nice one-to-one map, right? And we can parameterize it with a lot of free parameters that can be optimized, and that's then the machine learning part, right? Now, why this is useful for sampling? Well, the immediate thought is, of course, if we can learn an approximate trivializing map, or the inverse of a trivializing map, if you like, if this prior distribution can be something trivial to sample from, and the map takes us to the probability distribution we actually want to sample from, well, then we've solved our sampling problem, right? We just solved the trivial sampling problem, put the sample through the map, and off we go. It's embarrassingly parallel, no correlations at all. Life is great, right? This would be, in my view, the most aggressive way of trying to use a flow model to solve this problem. Let's think that through a little bit more concretely. Of course, you have to optimize your model. And I said, we don't have training data. If we had that data, we wouldn't be trying to generate it in the first place. But you can do that. Of course, as with any machine learning method, you're going to minimize some loss function, right? And the minimum of that loss function should be, in this case, at the distribution you care about. So anything you write down will work, as long as it has its minimum at this probability distribution we care about. But if you write down, for example, this would be a reverse KL divergence. It has this factor of the model probability distribution out the front, which means you can estimate this stochastically just by drawing samples from the model. So you don't need any training data at all, right? And you can still optimize this. If you like, one way of thinking about this is you can draw a sample from the model and you can push it through and you can say, with what probability should this have been generated? And with what probability was this generated? And take the difference and minimize it, right? So self-training. And then, of course, the map won't be exact and we have to fix it. But since we have a tractable Jacobian, you can just correct for that either by reweighting or by a Metropolis Hastings except reject step. So if you like, you're taking completely independent samples, you're composing them into a chain, and then you're except rejecting at the end. So you can correct for any inexactnesses in your sampling. So we have a machine learned approach to exact sampling in the limit of a large number of samples. Okay, so I'll give you just a sense of this, but proof of principle applications show that this can really work for this very high dimensional sampling problem. We see that we can fix this critical slowing down and topological freezing type problems. You can have really efficient parameter space exploration by essentially transfer learning or retuning your model or having conditional models. You can have direct access to this normalization here, the partition function. That's really hard to compute actually. And so the fact that the model gives you that directly is a fantastic benefit. But this is really only one of many uses of these types of flow architectures if we could design them, right? Direct sampling is, if you like, the most extreme. But you could do hybrid sampling. Even if your machine learning map is not very good, maybe it will get you into different topological sectors, different modes of the distribution, and then you can use your regular sampling algorithm to walk around inside those modes. You can map from one theory or one set of parameters to another. It doesn't have to be from something trivial to the end goal. It just could be from something that's a bit easier to sample using normal methods to the end goal. Contour deformation and density of stage approaches, this is essentially changes of variables on this very high dimensional space. You can use the same maps to do changes of variables to accelerate your calculations in other ways. So the entire problem boils down to just this. It's, can we write down the right architectures to map between these complicated high-dimensional probability distributions? And so this has been a research program that we've been following for 5 years or so, as I said, is can we engineer machine learning models for this purpose? So they need to be diffeomorphisms on these lattice gauge degrees of freedom. So that's isomorphisms of smooth manifolds, such that both the function and its inverse are smooth, right? They need to be encode all of our symmetries, because we have such high-dimensional symmetry groups. Trying to learn those stochastically just isn't possible. They have to be flexible, expressive. They have to be able to encode what the physics we know is there, correlations at the physically relevant scales. And then they just have to be, you know, very highly parameterized so we can optimize them. And so this is then the entire problem. Can we engineer our architectures? Okay, and then just a reminder of what you can do once you have them. Once you have your architecture, so you've parameterized this transformation, Then you optimize. Like I said, you optimize without any training data, just by drawing samples from the model, computing this loss function, gradient descent, iterate, then you save the model and you can sample from it in an embarrassingly parallel way. And that's the story. So I can give you a little bit of a sort of sense of this journey. Like I said, this is a really ongoing long-term research program to develop these custom architectures from the ground up. And so this is sort of the path we've been going on from first, how do you even do this for lattice field theories? And I'll give you a little bit of an example here, all the way through to now, where we're trying to scale up and run on the Aurora exascale supercomputer this year. And we'll see if we can actually do something at massive scale where each sample is a terabyte, you know. Okay, so I'll give this example. It's very outdated, but it's concrete. And it's the closest to image generation. So you can get a feel for the approach before we see the difficulties in our case. So a scalar field theory is a simple example of a field theory where you don't have a matrix on each edge, but the samples really look exactly like images. You just have real numbers on every site of some lattice. And so this is very close to the image generation problem. This probability distribution is just defined by some mathematical function, right? We can just compute it. And then we want to generate these samples with this probability distribution. All right, so fairly straightforward setup. Fairly straightforward setup. You can choose a prior to be just something like uncorrelated Gaussians on each side. The previous slide that didn't show up actually explained what the types of coupling layers. If we go back, will it show up? No. Can someone over there click the OK button? Yeah, okay. I'm sorry that the slide showing what this means is not present, but real non-volume preserving coupling layers, that's essentially something developed for images where you take half of the degrees of freedom and you transform them conditioned on the other half, right? And what that gives you is it gives you a nice upper or lower triangular Jacobian, which means that no matter how complicated that transformation is conditioned on the other half of degrees of freedom, you can still compute the Jacobian and inverse. Right, so that's really important. It gives you a way of writing down a really complicated math where you can still compute the Jacobian, right? So you can write down these coupling layers. You can see really small numbers of layers, really small neural networks parameterizing the transformation in these layers for this example. So this is not, you know, massive yet. You optimize, you stop, and then you sample. Okay, so in this case, you can actually see accelerated sampling. And of course, there's no free lunch. It comes at the cost of the model training, right? But what you see here, this is cost in some units on these vertical axes. This is the system size going from left to right. This is traditional sampling approaches. You can see that the cost grows exponentially. These are log axes here. And with the machine learning algorithms, the cost is flat going from left to right. That's as it must be, because if you've trained to some level, there's just no correlations between the samples in your chain. The only correlations left are from when you reject them or when you reweight them, because your model is not perfect. And the difference between this and this is these are less well-trained machine learning models. These are better trained machine learning models. And of course, the cost goes down if you train better, right? So no surprises here. The challenges are, of course, that there are many, many, many choices in architecture design that really, really matter. You have your choice of the prior distribution. I said, in this case, uncorrelated Gaussians. What's the width of those Gaussians? Are uncorrelated Gaussians really the right choice? You have infinite choices. What's the structure of the neural networks that go into your transformations? And this was 2019. It's now about four orders of magnitude out of date, right? So architecture development really, really matters. And we've been able to do four orders of magnitude better than what we could do simply by taking the best architectures for images, because our problems don't look like images, right? Even in this case, where they look almost like images, you can do many orders of magnitude better by designing your architectures for the problem. Okay, so then we step even further away from things that look like images, and you have to do sort of more aggressive ground-up engineering. And the first problem you face is that, well, pretty much all of the previous flow architectures before the time of this work a few years ago were designed to act on, say, real numbers. We don't have real numbers. We have these SU3 matrices. They live on compact connected manifolds. The very first thing is you have to design architectures that don't act between real numbers, but act between compact connected manifolds. So even things like variables on the circle, right? That's a compact connected manifold. And you don't just want to take something and combine it at the endpoints, then you have to worry about discontinuities at the endpoints and so on, right? You have to be really, really careful that this is defined as a smooth one-to-one map. Of course, for the circle, this is not so hard. People have written down transformations on circles before, things that we can use. So one example would be a Mobius transformation that's mapping this number on the circle Z to another one, and this is parameterized by omega, right? Really simple transformation, one parameter. You can't make this more expressive by composing it, but you can take convex combinations, then it's no longer analytically invertible, but you can invert it numerically using a bisection search, right? You need to think about how these things are invertible all the time. But this omega, for example, could be the output of some complicated neural networks. So you can make this more complicated transformation. You can write down circular splines. These are invertible transformations on circles. You can write down non-compact projections. This is projecting to the real line and back, but then you've got to be really careful with numerical instabilities at the endpoints. Actually, you have to Taylor expand around the endpoints to make this stable. It's not even defined at the endpoints, but you can continue in the gradients defined, right? So you can define these sorts of things. Then symmetries, right? So there's a lot of debate in the machine learning community broadly on sort of the value of putting in domain knowledge, things like symmetries into architectures. In our case, we have something like a 10 to the 12 dimensional distribution with a symmetry group of about the same size. There is no way you can imagine stochastically learning that, right? And we find in practice, if you don't build these symmetries in exactly, you get nowhere. And of course, why that's true is pretty obvious when you have such a high dimensional symmetry group. If we have a flat direction in our probability density space, building that indirectly means we can use all of our expressivity in describing the other directions rather than trying to mock up and learn this flat direction and spending all of our optimization time trying to learn the fact that it's flat in this massive dimensional space, right? So we have to build this in. It's also not essential for the correctness, however, right? Because we know the map won't be exact, we have to correct it. And that correcting will fix also the symmetries not being encoded exactly. So it's not essential in principle, but it is essential in practice. And so then you have to worry about, well, how do I build in symmetries? You can build equivariant transformations. That means that you want the prior to be invariant, and then you want the transformations to commute through every step of your complicated transformation that you're building out of, say, layers in your machine learning architecture built out of neural networks, right? You want all of your transformations to commute through. Now, I'm not going to go into huge amounts of detail, but I'll remind you the type of symmetry group that we care about here is that we have here a matrix on each edge, and we're going to, that's this matrix here, and we're going to left and right multiply by different matrices in, say, the SU3 group, these 3x3 complex matrices. And so those will be different at every site of the lattice. So it turns out you can write down architectures that are equivariant under this complicated transformation. And, oh, this is really disappointing. Can we maybe go out of full screen and see if we can see this slide? Can you maybe open with a different PDF viewer? Sorry, they go fine in the PDF I sent. Well, okay, what this box has is the hint I wanted to give you of the complexity of the transformations you have to write down. In this case, you can show that the most general thing you can do is you want to think about transforming the eigenvalues of all of these matrices in such a way that you transform the eigenvalues in permutation equivariant ways while leaving the eigenvector structure intact. And so what you end up needing to write down is you have inside your architecture eigendecompositions across this very high dimensional space, transformations on all of the eigenvalues, which are parameterized by complicated neural networks, right? And then you have eigenrecompositions and put it all back together at the end, right? And then you're back propagating through this, very complicated architecture, right? And so it has these many pieces, it has these eigendecompositions, then you have to write down what the transformations on the eigenvalues actually are, which also have to respect this symmetry. Then you start to want to define things like gauge equivariant neural networks in order to condition the transformations on the eigenvalues. But these are all things you can do. So in the interest of time, I guess we'll skip past the diagrams illustrating all of this. Oh, and this slide isn't showing up well either, but okay. You can see that despite the complexity of the architectures we have to define, you end up with the same sort of picture. You have some prior distribution. And if we imagine just numbers on the circle instead of our complicated matrices here, you can really picture what this looks like. You might have uniform on every link. You have some number of these gauge equivariant coupling layers, where inside those coupling layers, the kernels, those are the things that are transforming the eigenvalues here. They could be these non-compact projections on circles, where the parameters of the non-compact projections are given by the output of neural networks that might be gauge equivariant neural networks, right? So this really complicated many-layered architecture. Then you optimize it, and, well, it works. Oh, and this slide's also not showing up well, but you can see the main feature of the slide, which is, unfortunately, you can't see the definition of this quantity. This thing here is the topological charge of a gauge field. If you like, this is a winding number of the gauge field. It's something that's quantized by the Itiyo-Singer index theorem. It's a global quantity, if you like. And what you see here is this line here, also the legend isn't showing up, is what you get sampling with traditional approach from Hamiltonian or hybrid Monte Carlo. And what you see is that this isn't moving. That's because it's stuck in a topological sector. Imagine a multimodal distribution is just walking around in a mode and it can't get out. This is another conventional sampling algorithm that works in this context. This is a heat bath. This is doing a little better, but it's still really stuck. And then the flow-based sampling is the orange, and you can see it's just completely uncorrelated, and that's because it's not an update-based approach, right? It doesn't get stuck, right? And so you see this, and if we convert this into a cost per independent sample, and this here is changing a parameter of the theory that makes the lattice spacing small. So this is where the conventional sampling approaches get exponentially more expensive. You can see the machine learning model remains fairly flat. And over here, it's several orders of magnitude more efficient than the conventional approaches. And so this is a genuine measure of the cost, because the cost per update is about the same for these. So this is also still a couple of years ago. And as we had before, we're now several orders of magnitude better than this. You see this slight increase here in the cost of the machine learning algorithms. That's because it gets harder to train. Again, no free lunch. You're trading off benefits in sampling for cost of training. And the big question will be, can we even train at the sort of scale we care about? Okay, you have more problems. Multimodal distributions, you really need to make sure that you're sampling from all modes, not just in principle in the limit of a large number of samples, but in practice. How do you avoid mode collapse in training? You can do it. You need to deal with fermions. So fundamental particles called quarks, they're fermionic, and that means they're represented by grass money and variables, anti-commuting variables. How do you put anti-commuting variables into neural networks? Well, you have to, well, in practice, what you do is you integrate them out and you replace them with auxiliary variables, which have their own complicated symmetry structures, and you have to design entirely new neural network architectures to deal with these. We've done it. And what you're seeing here is the measured value of an observer, yeah. This slide's fine, and I've already got a time warning, so let's go through. If someone asks questions, we can show one of them at the end. Okay, so this is a measured value of some observable in a theory with both these complicated gauge symmetries and with fermions, these anti-commuting variables. This is the real answer. This is with traditional sampling, and what you see is here, the uncertainties go down. This is the number of samples. The uncertainties go down with square root n, but the answer just looks wrong. That's because it's stuck in one topological sector. We didn't continue this chain because this has to be run in series. You can't run it in parallel. And so getting this number of samples takes a really long time, right? If you run multiple chains, eventually you see that enough of them have tunneled that you get the right answer. But with the flow-based sampling, you just converge directly to the right answer, and it's embarrassingly parallel. So this took much less time than these combined, right? So you have efficient sampling evens in regions of parameter space, where conventional sampling algorithms fail. And I should say at the scale of state-of-the-art calculations, 10 to the 5 is big. So you would never get into this regime where the conventional algorithms converge. Then we have to put it all together to our actual physics theory, which has all of these moving parts. And so this was last year, the big excitement that we put it all together and it works. These are just a number of different observables that you can compute. This was the topological charge, this thing that was really frozen in conventional sampling. You can see, you really see this multimodal distribution coming out. All of the other observables come out nicely. This isn't a region of parameter space where conventional sampling does work. So you can compare. Everything agrees at really high statistics. And then the big question is, well, can we do it for the cases we really care about? All of the pieces are in place, but now we need to do all of the work of the QCD specific engineering and development. Like I showed with the other examples, we got orders of magnitude improvement once we started engineering for specific theories, not just even for the general structures. Now we've got the components. Now we have to scale. And this is really a problem of scaling these custom machine learning architectures to the same scale of state-of-the-art machine learning applications in other areas. So we're looking to run on Aurora, on tens of thousands of GPUs, and train an entirely custom architecture, which is not at all trivial, getting that to even work at scale, support for custom architectures. So this is the last piece of the puzzle, and that will be the question for the next 5 years or so. We're going to try this year on Aurora, but it'll be a long-term question because we're competing with methods that have been optimized for over 30 years. And the BlueGeneQ series of supercomputers was developed in collaboration with lattice field theorists for the conventional sampling algorithms, right? And so now we're trying to run new algorithms that can beat those, which requires a similar level of devotion to engineering. Okay, so where we're at is we have provably exact, in the limit of a large number of samples, machine learning algorithms that are orders of magnitude more efficient than conventional algorithms and overcome these particular problems that we have of this critical slowing down and this topological freezing. We've seen that we get unbiased results where traditional approaches fail. And the question is, can we do it at scale? And just because I'm a physicist, come back to the why for the last slide. Well, we have systematic limitations, everything from trying to understand the structure of the proton through to G-2 of the muon that's received a lot of attention in the press in the last couple of years, that there's a tension between theory and experiment. One of the big uncertainties in the first principles calculations is exactly the uncertainties we're trying to overcome here. We want to be able to calculate nuclei. This is sort of one of my big things, is that I want to understand how you get nuclear physics, not from models, but from the standard model. And we can just start to do that. And if we had just an order of magnitude better algorithms, we could really start to see, you know, dark matter direct detection, nuclear reactions, Big Bang nuclear synthesis in the first seconds after the Big Bang. We can really compute that all from fundamental physics, and we're so close. Okay, so to summarize then, the message that I really want to pitch is that we can use machine learning for theoretical calculations, you know, where you have an exact result that you're trying to achieve, and it's just a problem framing question. And there's high impact applications in development across many different theory areas, not just this one, but it really needs these two things. You really need to develop custom architectures, typically from the ground up, which is a long-term program. And it requires real engineering and scaling those up to state-of-the-art high-performance computing facilities. Thanks.
You alluded to the mode collapse problem, and I was wondering if you could say a little bit more about how you deal with that. I guess that's a real issue for the use of flows in my own area, and so I'd be really interested to understand kind of how that gets engineered away in your case.
Yeah, so multiple different strategies. The simplest of them is, and in parameter space, we know exactly how it changes from a single motor distribution to a multimodal distribution. And so you can simply anneal. You can start from the single motor theory and anneal to the multimodal theory, and you have no mode collapse. We also have these compact connected manifolds, which means that starting with density everywhere really saves you from this problem also. For the scalar field theory, where it's a real number at each site, you have to put a Gaussian down on each site. Then, of course, if you really want a density over on the edges of the Gaussian, you're sort of hosed because you'll never see it. If you have a circle and you just put uniform density everywhere, you're not going to hit that issue.
I see. So you, in essence, know kind of in some ways where all the modes are. You can sample where all the modes are and then kind of grow into them. I guess our issue is that we often don't know the
types of modes, right? And no, you don't know. So for example, the topological modes, we don't know how to write transformations that would jump us into those. Otherwise, we would just use our traditional sampling algorithms and jump. However, because of the support everywhere on these compact manifolds, you just go into the topological modes without any mode collapse at all. If you're looking at something like a scalar field theory where you have these sort of spatial modes, it's different, and you can get yourself into things like mode collapse. But there, if you anneal from the theory that you know has a single mode, even if you don't know how many modes you're going to, you can make sure you have support everywhere. There's also things you can add to the loss functions that really give you more geodesic type flows that help a lot. We can chat more on coffee break. There's like a whole fleet of solutions that we've developed.
Do you think flow models can be helpful in cases where there's a sign problem? Like, could I flow towards a larger value of the chemical potential or the theta parameter or something like that?
Yeah. So I think, yes, you can do that. I'm maybe more excited about using flows to do contour deformations in the case of sign problem type problems, where you essentially deform the contour to a place where the sign problem is weaker. And you can use the same types of architectures. We've developed this to do that. We have a few papers on that too.
Right.